Welcome to Counterpunch with Trevor Loudon. Please like the show, share the show, subscribe to Counterpunch, subscribe to Epoch TV. You're going to see more information about the communist worldwide revolution and how to fight it than you'll see anywhere else. Today, I'm a very proud man. It's taken over 3 years, but we've finally launched our full-length documentary, Enemies Within the Church. It's been a struggle. I've worked with Kerry Gordon, the pastor from Sioux City, Iowa, my good friend Judd Saul, who produced my 2016 documentary, Enemies Within, which looked at the Marxist and Islamist infiltration of the US Congress and Senate, John Harris, and several other people to put together something I think is pretty darn special. Enemies Within the Church, I believe, will be the most shocking thing that most Christians and non-Christians will have seen for many, many years. It is produced with the idea in mind that only truth can save us now. We've got to stop sugarcoating things, we've got to say it like it is, and American Christianity is in huge trouble, and unless this is exposed and counters, it's going to take down the culture and the country. So whether you care about Christianity, whether you're Jewish, whether you're atheist, agnostic, Buddhist, Muslim, if you love freedom, you have to care about American Christianity. American Christianity is what built this country. You know, the founding fathers fought the revolution over religious liberty. They had fled Europe where there were state churches everywhere, and if you did not conform to the state church, you could end up overtaxed or dead or jailed. It was that rough in many places. So they came to this country and they had this strange idea that had never been tried before in world history. The idea that man's rights come from God, not the government. This was revolutionary. This was a departure from all of world history where you'd had divine right of kings, where the king spoke to God and together they worked out the plan for the peasantry. The peasant shall give me every fourth son for my army, every third daughter for my court, 20% of their grain harvest every year for my taxes. And it always happened to be that God agreed with the king. Well, the American Revolution was founded on a very different principle. Man's rights come from God. The only purpose of government is to protect those rights. And what God gives, government cannot take away. That's what built America. The Christian foundations, the rule of law that came from that, the representative government that came out of Mosaic law, that set Americans free. That enabled them to become prosperous, to become rich, free, to build universities, to build churches, to build schools and businesses and tame the frontiers and eventually to fight wars and set an example to free other nations, all based on Christian roots. So if you are an enemy of America, would you not want to influence American Christianity? If you wanted to destroy America, and this country has had enemies since the revolution, you know, for a start, it was the princes of Europe who didn't like this idea that rights came from God, because what if that spreads to my country? And then it was the communists, who were a complete opposition and competition to God, who didn't want God ruling the earth. They wanted to rule the earth in their own right. They were gods. Their state was their instrument. So there's a little bit of a history to this. And we go into the history here because people need to understand the background. You know, the big problem with American Christianity for many years has been pietism. And that is the concept that Christians should not get involved in what they would call politics. Well, what about rephrasing that? Do Christians have civic responsibilities? If you have a responsibility to your church and to your family and to your community, why do Christians not have a responsibility to the civil government, which controls all of those institutions and will destroy those institutions if it gets out of control? The roots of this false pietist movement went back to Germany just after the Reformation. After the Reformation, the Protestants broke away from the Catholic Church. They had a new energy. They wanted to get involved in everything, to spread Christianity into every corner of the globe and every area of their lives, their business, their cultural lives, their artistic lives, their political lives, everything. This movement swept Germany and it went into Scandinavia, but there was a counter movement. the Pietist movement. And this said, no, Christians should not be involved in all these areas. Christians should stay in their churches, stay in their communities, be very observant, pious Christians, but have nothing to do with politics or culture or anything of that nature. And this movement was very popular. It was funded by some of the main princes of Europe, King Frederick of Prussia, for instance. They started putting pietists into university positions. They started promoting pietism. These kings and princes did not want these pesky Christians involved in politics. That was diluting their power. They had to put a stop to it. So the Scandinavian countries and Germany became very pietistic. The Christians didn't get involved in civic affairs. Now that created a vacuum. It's no accident that communism started in Germany. Karl Marx, his followers tried to start a communist revolution in 1848. They almost succeeded because there wasn't a strong Christian opposition to their movement. The princes and kings had to suppress it. As thousands of German communists moved to America, to the Midwest, to Milwaukee, Chicago, Minneapolis. And they set up socialist towns, they set up a socialist movement because Scandinavian and German pietists had settled the Midwest ahead of them. And so they were moving, they were finding the communists found the same pietist movement that enabled them to come to power in Germany, in the Midwest. They set up the American Communist Party in Chicago. It was decided very early on by the worldwide communist movement, and it was in existence well before the Bolshevik Revolution, that American Christianity, Western Christianity, had to be a major target. The very first communist front in America was set up years before the Bolshevik Revolution. It was the Methodist Committee for Social Action. The communists in the 1920s told their people, if you're brought up Catholic, go back into the Catholic Church. You're brought up Baptist, go to the Baptist Church. If you're brought up Episcopalian, go back to the Episcopalian Church, not to help and learn from Christianity, simply to be able to use the influence of the churches to promote socialism. Because the churches had what the communists lacked. They had money, they had influence, and they had respectability. So they went into the churches to spread communism. And they found a ready, because so many American Christians were pietists, they were suckers for this. Many Protestant clergymen signed up for Communist Party fronts in the 20s, the 30s, the 40s, the 50s. They set up the National Council of Churches, which affiliated to the World Council of Churches, which was run by the Soviet KGB. So you saw American Christianity, mainstream Christianity, moving to the left. And they were preaching solid socialism with a little sprinkling of Christianity on top. And many American Christians either left the movement altogether, left the faith altogether, or moved into evangelicalism, moved into the evangelical churches, because they were much more on fire. They were much more on fire for God, for Jesus. They were much more biblically observant. They were much more earth orthodox in their Christian interpretations, and they tended to be politically conservative. Because really, you know, if you believe in a Bible that promotes individual responsibility, you have a direct relationship with God, and you must observe the rule of law, you're going to be a political conservative. You can't be a socialist if you really understand the Bible correctly. So this sparked a counter-movement. As more and more Christians moved into the evangelical movement and the evangelical movement spread, the left-wingers in the Christian movement decided to infiltrate the evangelicals. In the 1970s, you had Jim Wallace, the former SDS Marxist from Sojourners. You had Ron Sider. You had Richard Mao, another SDS member. They all got together. They founded a movement called the Chicago Declaration, which called for social justice, all the left-wing talking points. But it didn't really fire, it didn't really capture the imagination of American Christianity. What did capture the imagination of American Christianity was the moral majority, the Reagan movement of the 1980s. Falwell and Pat Robertson, they moved the American evangelicals even further into supporting conservatism, supporting Ronald Reagan, supporting Israel. They really moved them into an anti-communist direction. And so meanwhile, the left-wing evangelicals had to start going into the Bible colleges. They became academics. They moved into the universities, into the seminaries, and started to preach their doctrines there. They're also joined, they had some help, because in the 1970s, a lot of young American leftists didn't want to get drafted to fight communism in Vietnam. They were much happier to take a draft deferment and go and preach communism in the seminaries. So you started to see this left-wing infiltration of the Bible colleges and the seminaries. Now, those people who went in there in the 70s are now running these institutions. Most of the Bible colleges and seminaries in this country are run by Marxists. And they are promoting this woke brand of Christianity, this critical race theory, which is just Marxism applied to race rather than class. They're all about ending white privilege, social justice, welcoming illegal immigrants across the border. All of these Marxist programs they are supporting. So you've got to the point now, if you send your son or daughter to one of these places, they will almost certainly turn out to be a Marxist, not a traditional Orthodox Christian. And so there were secondary results from this too, you know. It started to affect the politics too. The young pastors who once would have supported Reagan and Israel were anti-communists are now coming out supporting Bernie Sanders and Palestine and socialism. And this is infiltrating the churches, infiltrating the Southern Baptists, the evangelicals, and a lot of secondary organizations. A lot of American Christians, they went through Campus Crusade for Christ, for instance, when they're in college. They donated to World Vision. They might have been in InterVarsity. All of these organizations, World Vision, which was a very anti-communist, genuine Christian charity, is now woke. It's now Marxist. InterVarsity is now Marxist. CRU, Campus Crusade for Christ, once one of the most vibrant student Christian organizations on the planet, is now fully woke. It's all about critical race theory. It's all about social justice. And they enforce this with a rod of iron. I'm really talking Stalinism here, folks. The colleges and these organizations, the seminaries, the Bible colleges, they are where the American universities were 10 years ago. Some of them are even worse. So you're seeing a huge infiltration of Marxism into these institutions. So this has had political effects too. You know, it was the evangelicals who supported Ronald Reagan. It was the evangelicals who supported Donald Trump. You think this might have upset the communist movement, the leftists in the church? All this work, they've taken over Hollywood, they've taken over the media, the Democratic Party, the unions, they've taken over big tech, they've infiltrated the universities. You know, they've got virtually everything under their control, but they don't have the darn evangelicals and they don't have the Baptists. And these crazy people go out and elect the Ronald Reagans and Donald Trumps and set them back 10, 15, 20 years in their movement. So beginning in the early 2000s, there was another attempt to bring the left into the evangelical movement. And one of the main culprits here is a man called Tim Keller of New York. Now, in our movie, we blow up a lot of sacred cows. A lot of people, a lot of Christians watching the movie will be shocked, because many of the people we expose are respected. They write books, they lecture at colleges, they hold massive conferences. You might have been to one of them, or two of them, or many of them, but you find these people are Marxists. You know, Tim Keller set up the Gospel Coalition. He brought in some conservatives, he brought in some Marxists. The conservatives have largely left, and now those Marxists have spread out and have major publications going. They hold major conferences where they're promoting social justice, critical race theory, ending white privilege, all of these Marxist talking points. And they have worked with the Ethics and Religious Commission of the Southern Baptists, the most conservative Orthodox Bible-believing denomination in the country, the largest Protestant denomination in the country. They have worked with them to bring Marxism into the Southern Baptists. A couple of years ago, the Southern Baptists adopted critical race theory as part of their church toolbox for dealing with racism. Critical race theory was started by bona fide American communists. It is all about criticizing American Christianity, the American system, tearing it down to promote it with Marxism. It's all about using racism to denigrate every American institution so that America can be changed into a Marxist socialist state. But it's part of the Southern Baptist toolbox now, through, promoted through people like J.D. Greer, the president of the Southern Baptist, by Al Mohler, the leaders of the Southern Baptist movement. These people are either turning a blind eye or consciously enabling the Marxist takeover of the Baptist seminaries and the Baptist institutions, all the while consuming huge amounts of money and all the while actually building fewer and fewer churches around the country and around the world. So this is going on. So why should you care about this? Well, if you're a Christian, you should obviously care about it, because this is your path to salvation we're talking about here. It's not going to do you much good watching our movie on a Thursday night and going to a communist church on a Sunday. You know, that's not going to get you where you want to go. And thousands of young people go to church every Sunday. They're directionless. They're looking for some spiritual foundation. They go to the nearest church and they don't hear anything about redemption, anything about the law, anything about the Ten Commandments. They'll hear a watered-down version of love and lots about critical race theory, ending white privilege, refugee resettlement, etc. And they think that is the path to salvation. That is the path to hell on earth. And there's a good reason for that, because it's promoted by Marxists and communists, and ultimately they are disciples of the devil. They want a revolution, all right. They want to dethrone God in heaven, and they want to overturn every one of God's institutions on this planet to bring this world into chaos. That is what they want to do. And thousands of American Christians are imbibing this stuff every week, thinking it's biblical. It's the opposite. So please, if you care about this country, if you care about your faith, if you have no faith, but if you just want to live free, get this movie. It will shock you. It will reorientate you. It will challenge you philosophically. It will challenge you theologically. It will challenge you to look at the reality of the world we're in today. It's in a pretty darn sad state. You know, Andrew Breitbart, great journalist, you always used to say politics was downstream from culture. The culture shapes the politics. Well, he could have added that your culture is downstream from religion. So the religion shapes the culture shapes the politics. If your politics are a mess and your culture is a sewer, what's that telling you about your churches? So if you want to change your politics and you want to restore your culture, you have to restore, you have to reorientate your religion. That's how it works. So please get the movie, take it to your church, get your friends around to watch it, get your pastor to see it. It'll be a great litmus test whether he is a man of God or he's just a weak guy doing an easy job till he retires. It'll be a real test. So if you want to see the movie, go to enemieswithinthechurch.com. You can order a hard copy DVD or multiple DVDs, or you can download pay-per-view and watch the movie on your computer or on TV. I'm super proud of this. This is going to be one of the most controversial documentaries ever released in any subject, I believe, because it's so uncompromising in what it says. There are Steve Dace, the famous conservative commentator from Iowa, saw the movie and talked about how his jaw dropped all the way through it. He said there are no sacred cows in this movie, none whatsoever. So if you've got a weak stomach, you might have to watch it in short bursts, but it's worth watching for everybody. So please go to enemieswithinthechurch.com. It will be an experience, I can promise you that. So thanks for watching. Please like the show, subscribe to the show, subscribe to Epoch TV. I want to see you again for future episodes. I'd love to hear your feedback about the movie. Put it in the comment section. I'd really like to know what you think of it. And we'll see you next time around. God bless America, and God bless everybody who loves freedom. Thank you.